As usual, Stalin leaves few witnesses to the dark side of his past. And Nadia's family are witnesses. First to go is Nadia's younger brother, Pavel. Kira is Pavel's daughter.
Before they arrested us, all of father's friends had been jailed, and he would say to Stalin, "You will jail me too, because these are my friends."
Pavel dies mysteriously. The doctor calls it poison. Stalin accuses Pavel's wife. The secret police come for her.
I suddenly rushed up to her and embraced her, but she ran away. Later, when she came back, I asked her, "Mother, why did you run away from me?" She answered, "You know, daughter, I was about to throw myself down the stairwell." I call on mother's acquaintances and they say, "You shouldn't visit us or they will jail us too." And later, I find out they have been arrested. Now I call on some other friends of mother's, and again I hear the same request. "You shouldn't appear at our place, otherwise we'll be arrested." And they are arrested too. I stopped going to see people.
Soon, it is Kira's turn.
They put me into a cell, having no windows, no door. They locked me in there, and it was dark, no light whatever. I remember that much, no light at all there. I began to choke, maybe out of fear, or it was simply terror.
Next to go is Nadia's older sister, Anna. Her husband is arrested and executed. Terrified, Anna makes herself invisible, hoping to escape Stalin's attention, but she blunders.
Her blunder was to publish a book in 1948 of recollections that was very much disliked by the leader. He was depicted as a common, simple mortal, but of course he was already the great one, the genius, the teacher of the nation, and so on. And suddenly this kind of book. Of course he disliked it intensely. Anna happened to sit at his table and he flung the words to Beria, "Remove this old fool."
And Stalin's secret police chief removes her to prison. Stalin's son, Vasily, an Air Force general, eavesdrops on his aunt's interrogation. Alexander Aliluyev is Vasily's cousin.
You see, he was present in the next room when Anna was being examined. They kept her standing 10 or 12 hours. They know how to do it. And she felt bad in all senses of the word. Vasily heard all this and, laughing ironically, told his wife about it. And she told the horrible story to her grandmother.
When Anna is released, after 8 years of solitary confinement, she is insane. Stalin now turns on the family of his first wife, Keto, beginning with Keto's brother, Alexander, and his wife.
We all lived happily together until 1937. Then Svanidze was arrested, Maria Anisimovna too. And by some trick, she sent a note to my mother saying how badly they were being treated and asking her to plead for them before Stalin. So mother went to Stalin and he told her first and foremost that she should never take upon herself such a mission in the future. And he must have said it very firmly. As for Maria's note, he kept it for himself. Mother learned later that they had sent Maria to some godforsaken place where she very soon died.
Alexander is told that Stalin will pardon him if he begs for his life. He spits in the face of his executioner. Hearing this, Stalin remarks, "My, what a proud fellow." Yakov, Stalin's eldest son, is despised by his father.
One day he drove Yakov out of the Kremlin with no clothes on. Imagine! He ran to our house stark naked. It was winter, freezing hard, and he had been running along the street like that. He said, "Whenever I met someone, I hid myself for fear of being arrested." He couldn't stand that kind of treatment, being constantly accused of something. Do you know, at one point he tried to shoot himself?
My husband witnessed an episode when they called Stalin from the hospital to say that Yakov had tried to commit suicide and a bullet had struck him in the stomach. But Stalin said, this is his affair. If he wants to live, let him live. If he wants to die, let him die.
What was so terrible was not the fact that Yakov tried to shoot himself, but that his father ridiculed him, saying, you can't even shoot yourself.
The war comes to Yakov as a means of escape. But his fate at Nazi hands is no better. The ill-fated Yakov is acutely battle-shocked. Then captured and imprisoned with hundreds of thousands of his countrymen. The Germans offer to ransom Yakov, but Stalin refuses. I have no Soviet prisoners, only traitors, Stalin proclaims. Yakov throws himself on the barbed wire and dies. As the wife of a traitor, Yakov's young widow is arrested and imprisoned. With Stalin for a friend, no one needs an enemy. Mortality runs high among his companions.
He contrived, I can't find a better name for it, a process of anti-intellectual extermination among his apparent friends.
He knew that in both appearance and intellect, he was their inferior, and this became his obsession. All of you are so polished, so handsome, so educated, and I'm not, so I'm going to destroy you.
First to go among Stalin's friends is Mikhail Frunze, a Civil War hero. Handsome and charming, he eclipses Stalin.
Of course, Frunze was like a thorn in Stalin's flesh. He would have destroyed Frunze in any case, perhaps in a car accident.
Stalin's technique is masterful. He insists, solicitously, that Frunze have surgery for his stomach ulcer. Viktor Malkin, son of Stalin's physician.
Frunze didn't want to be operated on. He told his wife that he felt entirely well. But Stalin insisted that Frunze should rid himself of his ulcer, that surgery was just what he needed. So the operation was performed, and it was immediately clear that there was no ulcer, just some old scars. That's why it lasted only 35 minutes.
After the operation, Stalin calls on his friend at the hospital and leaves this note. Dear chum, at 5 this afternoon, Mikoyan and I dropped in for a visit, but Dr. Rozanov wouldn't let us in to see you, the rascal. You mustn't feel lonely, old pal, because we will be back again soon. Greetings, Cobber. 40 hours later, Frunze leaves the hospital as a corpse. As Frunze's coffin is lowered, Stalin remarks, may all of my old friends sink into the grave this gently and simply.